I of self-confidence that should be a big deal to promoting the compensation. It's the same process we see in traditional colonization. It's an exact parallel. Awareness of colonization process means that we can be individually addressed to a I wish that this audience was quite so, that the room were quite so flat so you could see the fact. The basic idea here is the idea of colonialism, that it's the colonialism of our ideas. And we know about colonialism, and it goes on to destroy those cultures and languages, but here we're talking about it destroying ourselves and our beliefs. Thank you. music side, to say, you know, oh, this is the world, this is technology, we have to respect parental choice, we have to respect the idea of choice and hope that people make the best one. We as special parents, we have to figure out how to fight those forces of oppression. Those laws, rules, and policies need to change. And even more importantly, we need to figure out how to teach ourselves how to heal ourselves. What's those forces of thought? What's it mean to generation to liberate ourselves? We need to be the generation that creates the view of deaf people in the world. Now, there will be times when we'll suffer from oppression. Our children, our grandchildren, however, fight the fight with the science. And our children will grow up freer, and they will benefit from that freedom of oppression. They will see the world in a better light if we do work. We have to remember, every time we engage in this discourse, what lens are we seeing? Are we seeing it as an oppressed victim, or as we seeing it as a strongly identified person? Okay, so warnings. These attitudes, these negative attitudes, sometimes come across in language. How many of you really think that in our institutions that we really truly value ASL interaction? We all know that that's not the case, right? We all know that ASL is still not seen as important as English. And this is not really an English problem. You know, I grew up in a deaf community. But did I really learn the linguistics and deep value of ASL? Not at all. Not at all. I learned how to use ASL. And finally, last semester, the first time I've been taking a course, ASL 270, with parent English and ASL. I am so happy. But I'm 44 years old and I'm now studying it for the first time. This is information I should be taking as a great school student. For those of you who are coming in and understanding it for the first time, we've been in the world of our world and realize it is not your problem. We need to recognize that the system has oppressed you and divided us. And what we need to do is make sure that we truly value ASL and celebrate ASL in ways that we do English, to really teach it, to really practice it, to really check in with each other, to make sure that we're using ASL in ways that are of the best way, to make sure that we can identify all the different parts of our language in the same way that we do English. All of that process is essential. Now, colonialism is interested in cultural control, but they are also interested in economic control, and that would be an example of this, actually, but in open languages. So we know that deaf people, although we might say that deaf people have always been in control. These are the Paris Bears. It happened previously. These were events that were hosted by deaf people. They had great discussions about philosophy and so forth. Deaf people came together to talk about ideas and philosophy and sign language. This was an international community. They were hearing persons who were included and invited and were quite involved. say that this speech, that speech cannot, that you can communicate with such a clear speech. We also recognize that some languages cross international boundaries and words that spoken languages do not. We also actually have some limitation to that. They also said that sign, they recognize sign is a gift to the people. People who did not know sign language were considered sign impaired. And deaf people's existence should not be called into question. People have the potential to be the world's first true and global citizens, and the final thing of the rules to ensure that all deaf people have the right to deaf education and experience sign language and socialization. This was back in the 1800s, folks. Okay? Now, this was a discussion that actually happened in Paris, France. And they actually were talking about the fact that everybody should learn sign language. That's how much they, as a whole, value. So many schools were established, ADL School was one of them, publications were established, many artists, writers, publishers came out of this period. They even fought and died in the French Revolution. They participated in French politics. And remember, we know the story about Walter's Kitchen. We know everybody signed there, so that's another example. So you see here that the experience of deafness was not negative. Let me say this, they also necessarily do not have the same opportunities that deaf people do. And I do want you to understand that these ideas were present a long time ago. And we're going to come to the big but. These are fabulous ideas, and this is amazing history. We know what happened in history. Understand this, you know, this Congress, when they kind of outlawed sign language, they actually didn't have the power to do that. They just went ahead and said, they declared it on their own. But what was fascinating was, is even though they didn't have the authority to declare this, it really took hold until the mid-1900s, 1960s. When finally sign language was reintroduced. This is a quote from the Count of the Rainbow. He said basically we need to erase any sense of deaf identity from deaf people. This idea, by the way, is still alive and well today. All over the world. This idea is not something that we have been able to imagine. So this gentleman, Meneer, you know, was rather paternalistic. He said, you know, even if deaf people think that they're fine, we still need to fix them and make them hear. These were results of these types of decisions. Trauma-related issues happen 2 times more often amongst deaf people. And I'm not talking about mental health disease or schizophrenia. I'm talking about real trauma. Okay? And the stats say that about 20% of the overall population experiences trauma. But for deaf people, that number is as big as 50%. Even half the people in this room have experienced severe trauma. I have from my experiences in South Dakota at the girls' school. I fought against them. And the South Dakota school today is closed. The only thing that is left around is a van that says outreach. I was there. I fought that fight. And then we have these ideas, but there is great division within the deaf community, and we lose as a result. Even though the school was known as a strong, bilingual school, and they had lots of deaf teachers, and the administration had lots of deaf representation, the board was different. And they just kind of waited for something to go wrong. We dreaded that, and my response to that was not good. A man from Harvard University. Sam Gallaudet. Looked at that dynamic of taking the language away, which was often the one as it was, and we identified a clear relationship between that type of experience and brain damage. And don't sit there and tell yourself that you're right. That's not the thing. Just know that that potential is there. We have brain plasticity, and our brain has a capacity to hear. However, we do need to know that we don't have language exposure from 0 to 5, building a super high level of communication, then we know that there are other ways that our brain has to figure out and take to accomplish the same things. That doesn't mean that it doesn't happen, it just means that they have to work harder. So any of you have experienced trauma and are still able to do this, you need to give yourself your athletic achievement. Okay, let me ask you this. How many of you think that, what percentage of deaf people do you think actually use ASL in the United States? This if you have 550 elected positions in the United States, this is elected, from mayor to city council to congressional representatives and almost 550,000. So if you calculate all that, think of the masses, today that means we would have 650 elected officials. We don't have any. Is about our process. That's what deaf is taking a look at who we are. Do we have lots of deaf CEOs out there? No, we don't. Again, so begs the question. And we understand that these decisions and these dynamics do have a real impact on us. Thank you. lay people, what does that mean?
These are just regular old folks on the street in Washington DC.
Do they control education of deaf people?
Not really. If you ask these types of people, the media will tell you they can't ask them. Now, there are some other people who would be surprised that deaf people can be able to hear, so we also have specialists. Specialists are the ones who actually do have power to make those decisions in our educational system. Who are those people? Your doctors, neurologists, schools, government, speech or language pathologists. Parents that I would encounter as specialists. And often parents are really pretty innocent in followers. They, of course, want their children to be the same as them. They're looking at doctors or those who have authority for dentists. Now, audiologists, by the way, I want to let you know this. You know, every year, audiologists earn $800 million. Speech language pathologists earn $1 billion annually, and they earn this off of your funds, off of our funds. To eradicate
this something we want to allow? I would think no. So in my Deafhood journey, I've examined this dynamic of autism. And let me be really clear, you know, today I've got about 10 minutes at most. I'm doing okay on time, but this is really a 20-hour course. So what I'm sharing with you is really just the highlights. I really have a series of lectures and education that helps you through this process. Today is really just a sampling, tasting it, if you will, at what's on there. I recognize that I'm white, male, straight, and able-bodied. And I know that please provide me with some privilege. And here at Gallaudet and for at residential schools, I may have an additional privilege of having that practice. I may have that. And it's debatable because they're still within the test system. Okay, so how much privilege would I get from that? I don't talk at all. I don't even try. So. I don't have that type of privilege. However, we know perhaps within our community there might be some advantages from that. And we do need to talk about that. It's a really important issue. Now, I have to also look at my distorted and unexamined views of racism, sexism, ageism, etc. Again, a lot of people say we shouldn't be talking about deaf blind or deaf black or any of these things, but it's really important. We need to stop that kind of talk, please. I think any time we say limp to each other is much like hearing people telling us to limp, and we should accept that from each other. So going back to my journey, I very much enjoyed teaching these concepts around deafhood. I also took the opportunity to examine my privilege. I also saw how hearing people responded. And I had to admit in my journey that the way I saw deafblind people was not as equal. And the Deafhood Foundation Board talked about bringing in several types of people, including deafblind. But we were concerned about paying for interpreters for them. And we were concerned about moving or a person with CP and sign slow. So I found myself having a reaction which was not so positive. I was worried about how it would impact time and so forth. And I saw that I was the one who was saying, hey, I
I And so I am still struggling. Well, I'm still good on time here. I should be done in about 5 minutes. So, while we're healthy identity, show you two recaps that we can watch in 7 minutes. So I'm not gonna lie.
I I I I